Hi, I'm Ian Small, CEO of Evernote, and we're back behind the scenes. In most of this series, we've focused on the applications that you use in the Evernote service and their functionality, their design, their user interface, and the new capabilities we're bringing to them as we renovate that level of the product. But Evernote is much more than the client apps that you use every day. It also includes the cloud that powers everything that you see. And today, we're going to go through those client apps all the way through the internet and up into the cloud in order to see some of the things we're doing to build a better foundation for the future. I'm here with Amir, who's a member of our senior management team in engineering, and he's going to talk to us a little bit about what his team has been dealing with. So Amir, tell me about some of the problems your team has been tackling.
So one of the problems we're tackling is our sharded architecture.
Sharded architecture. Okay, let's take a slow motion through those two words. What does that mean?
That means that we have so many notes that we can't fit them into a single database. So we have to have many databases, each with a subset of the notes, so that we can contain them all.
Okay, so instead of one big database with all the notes in it, we have lots of little databases with all the notes in it.
There are actually lots of big databases.
Okay, that makes sense. So what's the problem with a sharded architecture?
The easiest way to talk about the problem is to relate it to a wedding reception.
That explains why these pictures are on the whiteboard.
That's right.
Okay.
So here we have a traditional wedding reception. The guests come and they're assigned to individual tables that contain 10 people each.
Okay, so this is table 21. It's like shard 21.
That could be shard 21.
Sounds good. I had a wedding reception like this. It worked fine. What's wrong with this wedding reception?
Well, for example, as long as people in table 21 want to talk to each other, that works out pretty well. But if one of them wanted to talk to someone all the way at table 27, that's not as easy. Another problem is that if you wanted to add another course, that requires a lot of work. You have to reconfigure every single table with new cutlery, new plates.
Every single one.
Another problem is that this kind of setup requires a large wait staff.
And you know, at my wedding, we actually had some wedding crashers, not quite like the movie, but there were definitely wedding crashers, and we didn't have room for them.
Well, then you have to somehow fit them into a table that was designed for 10.
10 is okay, 11's kind of okay, 12, you start getting your elbows in somebody else's face, no one's happy anymore.
Yeah, nobody likes that.
All right, so now I understand what all the problems are with running a traditional wedding reception, but we're not running wedding receptions, we're running a service called Evernote.
Right.
So how do we map all these problems we've talked about to actual Evernote? The first thing you talked about was that it was hard for people at table 21 to talk to people at table 27.
Right. And that would be the equivalent of someone that's assigned to shard 21 trying to share a note with someone that's on shard 27.
Hard for the system to do that.
Correct.
Okay. You talked about the fact that it was hard for us to change the food we were serving because you have to change cutlery and stuff.
Yeah. And that would be the equivalent of us trying to deploy new features to the system and having to do it to all 750 shards.
Okay, and you talked about when wedding crashers show up, the tables get too crowded.
Yeah, and if we put too many people into a single shard, that shard becomes overworked and slow.
And that affects everybody in the shard at that point.
Correct.
Things aren't working. And the last thing was too many wait staff to support all this.
Yeah, and those would be our engineers that are trying to keep all 750 of these shards up and running.
Okay. So those are the problems with the architecture we have today. Is there a better way?
There is. So in the cocktail party, you're not restricting people to a certain table. They're free to roam around the entire space.
So everything's a little more mobile, a little more flexible.
That's right.
Okay. If this is a sharded architecture, what's the technical version of a cocktail party?
The cocktail party is the same as a horizontally scalable database.
Okay, those words again, horizontally scalable database. What does that mean?
So that's a database where one database can continue to grow as large as you need it so that you can put all your notes into one database.
So instead of before we had a database, one database per server, now we have one database that straddles many, many, many servers.
Right.
So if you were going to build Evernote today, which way would you build it?
This way, hands down.
Okay. So then why did we build Evernote this way?
Well, we did this 10 years ago, and at the time, this was the best way to scale.
That makes sense.
Unfortunately, this wasn't available when we built Evernote in the beginning.
So how do we get from this one to that one?
Well, that's the tricky part. We have to move 9 billion notes from this system to this system while our service is up and running. So that's equivalent to trying to refuel a plane while it's in flight.
So 9 billion sounds like a lot of notes. I'm assuming that doesn't happen in like a flash of a second. So it must take, what, minutes or hours?
No, it takes a couple months.
Okay. So we're going to be in a process of moving from one configuration to the other over the course of months without anybody noticing.
That's correct.
So you're confident this is going to work?
I'm very confident because we actually already did it in November.
If I put two and two together, that means through like maybe September and certainly October and November, any of our users who are using our system to make a note or edit a note or create a note or delete a note, they were doing that on top of a moving process underneath when all the notes were moving from one place to another.
That's correct.
Did anybody notice?
Nobody noticed.
So that's actually pretty tremendous. So now that we're over here in this horizontally scalable world, are there advantages of being in this world?
There are. For example, in this model, it's easy to get geographic redundancy.
Okay, and what is that good for, geographic redundancy?
That's good for making sure that there's copies of the notes in multiple geographic regions. So if there was a natural disaster in one region, there's still a copy of the note somewhere else.
Got it. So more likely to have a resilient, redundant system, more likely to be safe in the event of a natural disaster. That sounds good. What else do I get a benefit from here?
It allows a much easier sharing experience where we're not restricted to shards anymore. And just like in a cocktail party, anyone can talk to anyone.
Okay. And what about if we want to build new features or maybe put something other than notes in there?
It also allows us to do that. We can put things other than notes, where in this model, we were restricted to notes only.
So that sounds like a better foundation for us to build on.
That's right.
That's a pretty big step forward. So a lot of the work we've been doing that you've been focused on has, of course, been focused at the part of the product that you touch, the clients. And that makes sense. And that's why we focused a lot of this series on the work that we're doing at the front end. But the truth is, some of the hardest work that we're doing here at Evernote to build a better Evernote isn't just about making the Evernote that you have today better. It's about building a better foundation for us to build the Evernote of tomorrow. Transformations like the one we just talked about are incredibly hard to pull off, but vital to being able to have a new, much more exciting base off which that we can build the future. And it's people like Amir and the team that works for him who've been working really hard over the course of the last year to execute some of those things. So thanks, Amir. Thank your team for doing all this and for doing it without anybody noticing. It's kind of a cool trick. We hope you've enjoyed this episode of Behind the Scenes and learned a little bit more about what it takes to take Evernote into the future. We hope you see you next time behind the scenes at Evernote.